You're watching a Highwire Media podcast.
As Tom Sawyer learned when the people of St. Petersburg, Missouri gathered to erroneously mourn him, Huck Finn and Joe Harper funerals are wasted on the dead. Better to say all those nice things to the ones you love while they're still around to hear them. Brooklyn Nine-Nine briefly got to play the role of Tom Sawyer and learned the same lesson. For the day in between when Fox canceled the police comedy and NBC revived it, there was an outpouring of grief, the likes of which had rarely been seen for the abrupt end of a series, even one as beloved as this. Testimonials poured in from critics and fans alike, in a tone suggesting not just disbelief, the reassessment of a joyful series they hadn't fully appreciated until it was briefly gone. And an epiphany like that too. I love the show, often put it on my top 20 shows of the year list. There was also something that kept me from fully embracing it the way I had, like Parks and Recreation. Not being quite on par with one of the century's best sitcoms is no sin. Still, it was hard not to draw comparisons given the overlap in creative DNA character type. You can see elements of Leslie Knope in Amy Santiago, John Swanson in both Captain Holt and Rosa Diaz, and guest star casting, and to find Brooklyn ever so slightly wanting. I would dwell on minor flaws sometimes, particularly the show's struggles with the high-class problem of having too many funny characters and not enough time to properly service them all. This sounds like a silly thing to object to, but because the show tried to feature everyone in every episode, it usually led to at least one subplot each week featuring undercooked. So even as I praised it, I also found myself focusing more on the few things Brooklyn couldn't do well, rather than the many things it could. Not anymore. Even though odds seemed good that the show would find a post-Fox home, the mere idea that it might not come back was enough to shake loose most of my quibbles as I thought about all I would lose. Start with dramatic powerhouse gifts being used in service of the silliest jokes, like finding out that an all-pro quarterback is also the world's greatest pastry chef, or the way the series smartly dodged all the usual will-they-or-won't-they traps as it slowly turned Santiago and Sandberg's goofy Jake Peralta from rivals to lovers, and at the end of the last season, spouses. TV conventional wisdom says happy couples ruin sitcoms, but Brooklyn has only gotten funnier the closer Jake and Amy have gotten. It helps that the show has the discipline to do explicit Jake and Amy couplehood stories only occasionally, and pairs both characters off with other regulars in between so that episodes about them feel special. Or the way that supporting players like the stoic Rosa, Terry Crews's excitable Terry Jeffords, or the weirdo enthusiast Charles Boyle have become so well-defined after 5 years that slight variations on their familiar quirks, say Terry's love of yogurt, can generate huge laughs. Mostly though, what that near-death experience made me appreciate more than ever before is the same emotion that Parks so often elicited, the joy of getting to watch exceedingly likable characters do and say ridiculous things while still ultimately caring about each other and the world around them. Comedies about nasty people who are colorfully awful to one another can be great. But in troubled times like this, comedy about nice people trying to do good things can be a real balm. I laugh early and often at this show, but I also just smile at the thought of it, even on days when smiles can otherwise be hard to come by. Comedies can often feel strained at this advanced age, when it feels like there's nothing new to learn about the characters and the only way to generate laughs is to get broader and broader. That doesn't happen here. And the second episode reveals a lot of amusingly weird information about squad imbeciles Hitchcock and Scully. If anything, the series feels more in a groove than it did when it was young and new and still surprising. The fourth episode says goodbye to Gina as a regular character. It's wonderful, showcasing the many different styles of humor the series manages to incorporate, even as its tone overall leans on Sandberg's man-child exuberance. And while Gina is a funny character, the period last season when Peretti was on maternity leave suggested that this will be a case of addition by subtraction. if only because the show won't have to strain so hard to give everyone their moments each week. When reports began to surface that the show was in jeopardy, I tried to be prepared about it. 5 years would be a healthy run for most sitcoms. It would prevent a possible decline phase, and yes, it was still too easy for me to hold it an emotional distance. Cancellation actually happened, though. The distance collapsed to a few millimeters at most. Brooklyn Nine-Nine was too good at being good at telling jokes and making me happy to go away. There are all kinds of complicated financial explanations for why the show ended up at NBC, and why it might stick around a lot longer than what previously people suggested would be a sixth and final season. Mostly, though, it feels like someone who works there realized they needed Brooklyn to continue existing just as much as its lucky audience does. Let me know your thoughts in the comment section below. Give me your take on season 6 of Brooklyn Nine-Nine. And of course, if you want to support the channel, you can buy us a coffee at buymeacoffee.com/cinemagoal. As always, you can find us on Good Pods, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, anywhere you get your podcast platform. Leave us a review on YouTube, Spotify, Good Pods. And as always, thank you so much for watching and listening. We'll see you next time.